year and a half.
Hi, I'm Kelly Corrigan, and I'm here with someone who is not related to me, but I wish you were. This is Maureen Corrigan.
Oh, it's great to be here.
It's great to meet you. So you have written a memoir, and you have this great book of criticism, which with a beautiful cover. And you also have the best job in America because you get to do book reviews. But you also teach at Georgetown.
Yes.
For 25 years?
25 years, yes.
Yeah. Of enlightening you have the young. Readers, you have listeners, and you have students. I wonder if you have a perspective on where we are as a nation of readers, if we're getting smarter and more astute or lazier, or what are the trends you see?
I think we're getting antsier as a nation of readers. I don't think it's that we read less. In fact, what studies that have been done show that students are reading more these days because they've constantly got different blogs, different types of outlets open on their computers and their devices. Mm-hmm. But it's that they're not sitting still and losing themselves in a longer piece of work.
Mm-hmm.
I used to, when I started out at Georgetown 25 years ago, I'd assign these giant doorstopper 19th century novels, Jane Eyre and Dickens and David Copperfield, 1 week after another.
Yeah.
And the kids, as far as I know, they certainly did a good job of convincing me that they read everything. These days, I have to leave a longer space of time, not because the students are not as smart. They're just not used to that sense of sitting down for an hour or two and reading without a break.
What does that portend? I mean, what do we lose when we lose the ability to get lost?
I think maybe it portends shorter works of literature or works of literature that are written differently. Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting to me these days when you can read the first chapter of a new novel on Amazon, for instance, that it seems like a lot of times novels are front-loaded in that opening chapter in order to sell the book. So I wonder how...
So we're writing to the market.
Well...
Maybe.
Maybe we are.
That's
maybe
interesting.
Maybe we always were. You know,
so I wonder if you have an opinion about how the bestseller list, it's so prominent in the lives of publishers, and it is everyone's goal, and it's printed there every Sunday. I wonder if you have an opinion about what that's driving in terms of the creative process.
Well, I think the bestseller list usually privileges stories that are plot heavy and character driven. And I'm speaking as somebody who's just written a book in praise of what I think of is the greatest American novel, The Great Gatsby, which is voice driven. It's that oddest of literary animals. It's not plot driven or character driven. I think that as a book critic, I see a lot of knockoffs in the 200 books I get a week from publishers hoping for a review. I see a lot of knockoffs of the books that are on the bestseller list. A lot of vampire books.
Yes.
Still a lot of dog books.
Yes.
So that kind of thing.
Yes, and now we're going to have shades of gray and green and blue.
No, stop.
So this would never have been on the bestseller list had they been keeping tabs at that time, right?
I hope you're talking about Gatsby and not my book, which
I'm
so still
sorry.
Have great
That's
hopes
right.
for.
That's right. Let's put this on the bestseller list.
Gatsby would not have been on the bestseller list. It didn't sell that well. Remaindered copies from the 1925 printing, that's when Gatsby came out, remaindered copies were still in Scribner's warehouse upon Fitzgerald's death in 1940. It was a disappointing book in terms of sales and critical reception.
And what does that do for him as a writer? So if it had been more enthusiastically reviewed or received by the reader, do you think he would have written more?
I think he would have spent less time tearing himself apart, wondering why it didn't sell.
Yeah.
You know, Fitzgerald writes all these letters, especially to Maxwell Perkins, his legendary editor, saying, I should have given it a different title. It should have been longer. It was too short. And then it's so interesting. He writes this letter and says, I didn't include any likable female characters.
I know, I remember
reading
that.
And women drive the fiction market, which is what we say today.
Yeah.
You know? And there was all that flap last year over Claire Massou's book, The Woman Upstairs, which was criticized for not having a likable woman at the center. She was kind of brusque and unlikable. Yeah. Why do women have to be likable in fiction? So it was so interesting that Fitzgerald had that sense back
had
in 1925.
That. Yeah. Yeah. That it was a femme fatale and a dead woman were not enough to
and
drive sales.
And a tough woman. You know, Jordan Baker is not particularly someone you want to cozy up to.
And when you first read this in high school, it didn't do much for you either.
I thought it was a boring novel about rich people. And since I grew up closer to the Valley of Ashes, so to speak, in the novel, I grew up in Sunnyside, Queens, then certainly I didn't grow up on East Egg or West Egg.
Yeah.
It felt like,
you were disinclined.
What is this about?
Yeah. And so do you think, you know how they say youth is wasted on the young. Mm. Do you think that some of these novels are wasted on the young?
Sure.
Like it's a terrible mistake to put this in the hands of a reader too soon because maybe they'll never come back.
Yeah, but you know, the wonderful thing about putting it in the hands of our high school students is that, certainly as a college professor, I can assume that 99.9% of the kids entering my class as freshmen, they've read The Great Gatsby. Mm-hmm. That's our national American novel. No other novel comes close in terms of how many Americans have read it.
Mm-hmm. And that's a thing that's getting lost, right? Mm. There's too much content, and everything's bifurcated. I mean, we saw watch the same television show on the same night, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
So just having a book that we could all talk about, like a giant national book club, is really kind of a powerful shared language.
And not only is it a national book club, if only Fitzgerald somehow could know about this, right? When he died in 1940 at the age of 44, His works were nowhere. His last royalty check was for $13.13. But this novel, I'm pointing at my book, but I mean Gatsby. Gatsby has taken over the world.
Yeah.
They teach it in China. Any country that is curious about America, the American dream, what we are about as Americans, they read The Great Gatsby.
And what is it? I mean, I know it took you 300 pages to do it, but we've got like three more minutes. So can you hit it?
Yeah. Gatsby is about the doomed beauty of trying, of aspiration. Mm. You know, those last lines, so we beat on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past, but we beat on.
Yeah.
We're all going to die, you know.
And that's so specifically American,
right?
I mean, we're the ones that never give up. We don't accept our lot in life. We're the ones that are going to climb out.
Yeah, that's how we like to think of ourselves, certainly.
Yeah.
The novel celebrates that aspiration, but it also tells us it's limited.
Yeah. Think back to, so you're a teacher. Mm. What great teachers have you had in your life?
Oh, well, one of the great teachers I went back and visited for my book. I had a great teacher in high school, Mrs. Maureen Flood, who was my English teacher. I didn't read Gatsby with her, but I read Victorian novels with her. And when I went back to my old high school after almost 40 years, because I wanted to sit in on classes that were reading Gatsby for the first time.
Oh, how interesting.
She is still at the high school. She must have been 12 when I first had her. And she's the vice principal of the school. She remembers everybody. She said, come back, stay with me, come into class. I also had great teachers I went to Fordham in New York.
Good
as
Catholic
an undergrad.
Girl.
Good Catholic girl. I had the greatest teachers of my life there. Mary Fitzgerald, who took
another good Catholic
but
girl.
She knew Seamus Heaney. She knew all the Irish poets before they really became household names.
Mm-hmm.
As a college undergrad, I sat in a pub in Ireland with Seamus Heaney drinking beer and reciting poetry.
Fantastic. Boy, that'd give you the bug. That's the end of you at that point, right?
And he was lovely.
And what's the luckiest break you've ever had?
Getting on Fresh Air, and the fact that John Leonard, who was the book critic for Fresh Air at the time when I was invited to do a book review, said generously, bring her on board, there are plenty of good books to go around. I don't know if I would be that generous.
You should bar the door. You have the best job. And is there a review you've written that you deeply regret? That you've gone back to reread the book and thought, you know, I don't think that I...
Not recently. I started out writing reviews for The Village Voice when I was in my mid-20s. And I do remember a biography of Thomas Carlyle, the great 19th century British culture crank. And I remember I said about that biography in the review, this book needed to be done but it doesn't need to be read. I thought that was a great line. But that line has haunted me because it was kind of mean.
Yeah. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
What's the nicest thing someone said to you about this book?
You know, they've said they want to go back and read Gatsby again.
Mm-hmm.
They've said they didn't appreciate, you know, people have said they haven't appreciated Gatsby. The book has made them want to go back to school. It's made them want to read Fitzgerald. That was part of my evil plan with this book.
Uh-huh.
I want everybody to read Gatsby again.
Tell me this. You have seen all these different, like, not generations, but micro generations of students come through.
Yeah.
What are the most current associations with Gatsby?
Race, class, gender, sexuality. Those are the hot topics with Gatsby. Students these days focus on the end of chapter two, where you have this curious incident where Nick Carraway is at a wild party at Tom and Myrtle's love nest, and he goes off with a male photographer.
Yes.
And then there's a space in the text, there's a gap in the action, and Nick wakes up in the bed of the male photographer's apartment. And students really want to talk about whether this is a gay love story, whether Nick is in love with Gatsby.
Gatsby
in an erotic way. Could be. I mean, I don't think that there's anything in the novel that argues against it. I don't necessarily think that that's, you know, crucial to the reading of the novel. Nick loves Gatsby, whether it's erotic or not. You know, I'll let other readers decide.
It's sort of secondary, right?
Yeah, it's secondary. Also, students love to focus on the way the novel is nervous about foreigners, about people of color. And it's a novel of its time. It's 1925. The novel is nervous about this wave of immigrants coming in or recently come in. It's nervous about all of these African Americans coming into New York City during the Great Migration, during the Harlem Renaissance. But then you know, the novel has it both ways. The guy who's the most racist proponent of, you know, eugenicist race theories in the novel is of course Tom Buchanan, who we don't like. So where does the novel stand? We're not sure.
And that's what makes it such a great read.
I don't think Fitzgerald was sure what he thought about race and ethnicity and liberated
women. And that's the
best
novel, when you realize that the person who's writing it is discovering, is writing to discover, not post-discovery, where they're kind of laying out some
sort
of polemic that they're disguising as plot.
Yeah.
What a thrill to talk to you.
Oh,
thank you so much
thank
for coming
you,
by.
And I'm sure we must be related.
Yeah, I mean, we are now. We're spiritually related now, Maureen.
Right.